Bishut Torah v'Rabotai, with the permission of Hashem, the parasha of Vayeishev and the parasha of Vayishlach, there is a connection. Parasha Vayishlach, and that parasha we talk about the meeting between Yaacov and Esav. It was a meeting, it was supposed to be a fight, a war between them, but at the end there was no war, and without no war, Yaakov beat Esav and his angel that protect him. Why? The zichot of the Torah. Yaakov, he was a man of Torah. When you are a man of Torah, the Torah protects you, no problem. That is the parasha of Vayishlach, and that parasha we read about the rape that happened to Dina, the daughter of Yaakov, that she was raped, but by unfortunately Shechem ben Hamor, and there was a very big war between Yaakov and his children and all the nations of Canaan. And Hashem, he helped Yaakov Avinu and his children to beat them. It was a big war. You know, I don't know if you have time to read the Midrash, to read the story that all the wars that happened. All again, the zichut of the Torah protected Yaakov Avinu against all his enemies. When there is a call for Yaakov, again, the parasha of Vayishlach, there is a passage that when Yitzhak Avinu passed away, Esav and Yaakov, they buried him. Esav and Yaakov. Now, Esav, he was a Rasha. He was a Rasha. At least, he should let his brother Yaakov, that was a big tzaddik, to bury the tzaddik. Now, the Torah teach us Esav and Yaakov buried Yitzhak. What it is the lesson that the Torah want to teach me, that Esav and Yaakov buried Yitzhak? The message here is the Rishaim, they want to take advantage of the time. I remember one day, there was a man who came to see me, and he was very brown, he was very dark, you know, with the sun. He was wearing very light clothes, with a short, you know. He was smiling to show me his white teeth, you know. He was so, you know, very red, brown. He took a lot of sun. And he told me, you know, Rabbi, I am like you. I told him, you're like me? How? He said, your grandfather was Rabbi Chaim Pinto, yes. I said, yes. So he said, well, my grandfather, his grandfather, he is the X. You know, the Baal Shem Tov. I looked at him, and I told him, there is a big difference between you and the Baal Shem Tov. You cannot compare. It's a shame for Baal Shem Tov that you mention that you are his grandfather, that you are his grandson. It's not a... I mean, if you were a Ben Torah like your grandfather, okay, it's a privilege. But now, I don't think it's a privilege to have gava, to have this gava, to tell me that you are the grandson of Baal Shem Tov. I said, Matai yagi'o ma'aseyadei ma'aseyavotei. I am David Pinto. My grandfather is a big tzaddik. But I cannot compare. I am even ashamed to tell people that I am his grandson. Because Rabbi Chaim Pinto is a big tzaddik. I am nothing. I am just nothing. I'm just small. I cannot have the privilege to talk like that. So exactly that's what we learn from this parasha. Esav, that was for him the best moment to show people, hey, Yitzhak is my father. I am his son. I am his Becho. I'm the grandson. But people know him. People know that he's a Rasha. People know that he's a killer. He's a thief. Esav, are you crazy? What you want to be proud of? That you were the son of a big tzaddik? What about you? Look at yourself. You understand? That's what we learned more or less from this parasha of Vayishlach. Now, what is the connection between the parasha of Vayishlach and parasha of Vayeishev? Well, there is a big connection, because the parasha of Vayishlach, we saw there a separation complete from Yaacov and Esav. That from now on, you couldn't live together. The Torah said, why you couldn't live together? Because they have a lot of sheep, a lot of animals. But hey, look at me, between you and me, there is space. Did you hear somebody changing a country, going to another country, because he has a lot of sheep? Huh? No, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. Because Yaakov and Esav, they had a lot of sheep, a lot, so they can't stay together. So when he remained in Eretz Israel, and the other one he went to Seir, outside Eretz Israel. Outside, completely, far away. From Me'aret HaMachpelah, from Be'er Sheva, from Hebron. It doesn't make sense. He says, you know, this is only an excuse. Esav, he didn't want to live with Yaakov. You know why? Because because now people, they know who is the tzaddik, who is the rasha. So he has a bad reputation. And knowing that he cannot change, everybody know him, so he had to go somewhere else that nobody know him there. And he can't stay. It's like, just imagine, it's so much embarrassing. Just imagine, Esav, if he will stay in Eretz Canaan, with Yaakov Avinu and his children, it will be very embarrassing for him. You know why? You know why? You know why? Because people, they see the difference between both of them. Because people, they see the difference. Look at a big difference. Big difference between Yaakov and Esav. This is the reason why Yaakov Avinu, Alav Shalom, he didn't tell him, get out from here. The country is for everybody. First reason, but the Hachamim said that Esav, he thought, if I stay in Eretz Canaan, if I stay in the land of Abraham and Yitzhak that means that I have to go to the exile with Yaakov to Egypt, and I don't want to go to exile. Don't want to get out from here. Because if he stay in Eretz Israel, that means that he accepts to go to exile, like Yaakov Avinu. No, he said, I don't want to go to exile. I prefer to, so from that moment, the Jewish separation between Yaakov and Esav started. A complete separation. Yaakov remained in Eretz Israel with the Torah, and the Torah that it's connected to Eretz Israel, because you know, to live in Eretz Israel, there is mitzvot you have to accomplish, like this year. This year is the Shemitah. You understand? This year is the Shemitah. So, for the Shemitah, there is mitzvot. There is a lot of mitzvot. If you want to live in Eretz Israel, there is a lot of mitzvot that you have to complete. There is. You know, Esav, he was the firstborn. He was a Bechor. When Yaakov, he told Esav, I want to buy from you the Bechorah, he told him, what's that Bechorah? He said, well, Bechorah, it's when the Beit HaMikdash will be built. You know, it's for the Kohanim, there is a lot of mitzvot connected in the Bechorah and Eretz Israel and Beit HaMikdash. And Esav, he said, no, I don't want. I'll sell you the Bechorah. That means that Esav, all the time, he didn't want to respect Torah and Mitzvot. And especially, he didn't want to live in Israel, because to live in Israel, you have to respect Mitzvot, that they are related, connected to Eretz Israel. So now the parasha of Vayeishev. Now, the more or less, I told you what the main headline in the Parashat Vayishlach. Now, Parashat Vayeishev. Parashat Vayeishev, a disaster. The Torah starts about Yaacov Avinu sitting in Eretz Israel with his father. You know that at that time Yitzhak Avinu was alive. And Vayeishev Yaakov be'eretz migorei aviv. He was sitting next to his father, a good neighbor. Only for the first time, Yitzhak Avinu, he had a good neighbor. Who was the good neighbor? Yaakov and the Shvatim. At that time, the Shvatim, they were all, most of them married. My friend, Yaakov Avinu, at that time, he was learning Torah with Yosef HaTzadik. But the Gemara said, Vayeishev Yaakov, bikesh Yaakov lashevet v'shalva, kafatz alav v'gzo shi Yosef. The Torah starts with Yaakov Avinu sitting that now he established himself in the Eretz Canaan. Okay? And now the Torah starts about Yaakov Avinu. Look what the Torah said. Look, it's incredible what the Torah said. Vayeishev Yaakov Eretz Megorei Eretz Canaan. Ele todot Yaakov Yosef. This is the descendants of Yaakov, Yosef. But no, Yaakov Avinu, he has 12 children, yes or no? So the Torah should say, Ele todot Yaakov. This is the descendants of Yaakov, Reuven, Shimon, Levi, Yehuda. And here the Torah said only, this is the descendants of Yaakov, Yosef. It's like, there is only Yosef. No, there is not only Yosef, there is others. So why the Torah mentioned Yosef? This is the genealogy. And the Gemara answered, because Yaakov Avinu, the main reason why, if you have Rashi, you will see Rashi's something incredibly said. That from Yosef starts the real story of the Bnei Israel going to Egypt. And Yaakov Avinu, all the Torah that he studied in the yeshiva, he teach it to Yosef HaTzadik. And now, from now on, the Gemara said, "Bikesh Yaakov l'shevet b'shava." The problem starts because Yaakov Avinu, he wanted to sit tranquil. You know, he wanted to relax. It's not a holidays, no. He wanted, it's not to go, Hashalom, no. He wanted to stay next to his father and to study Torah. But he wanted to study Torah with relax. And Hashem, he was not happy. Hashem, he said, no. Hashem, he said, at Tzadikim, they can only relax after 120 years when they go up there. In this world, there is no relax. Here, they have to study Torah. So that means, my friend, Yaakov Avinu Alav Shalom, because his attention was to study Torah by relaxing a little bit, not with effort. So Hashem sent him problems that Yosef was sold to Egypt. My friend, my question is like this. Do we are not allowed to relax? We're not allowed to go a little bit to the mountain to take some fresh air? And because Yaakov, he wanted to relax a little bit, he had to suffer? Is it normal? Huh? Is it normal that? Because a big tzaddik like Yaakov Avinu, now he was an old man, because he wanted to relax, he wanted to sit next to his father. His father was a blind man. And now he wants to teach Torah to his family. And because he wanted to relax a little bit, he bikesh. That means that Yaakov Avinu, Alav Shalom, till now, he was Yaakov Yoshev Ohalim. He was going from place to place to teach Torah, to learn Torah, to go Sheorim, he go Sheorim here, he go Sheorim there. Now we want to relax a little bit. Now he has 12 children. And the 12 children, they are opening yeshivot. They are doing zikui rabim. They teach Torah to people. They teach people how to believe in Hashem. And now Yaacov Avinu want to be the Rosh Yeshiva. He want to sit in the house. People that have problems, they come to ask him. And because of that, Hashem will punish him by Yosef. But Yosef disappeared. Why? Why HaKadosh Baruch Hu he didn't bring another, something else, that, like an excuse that the Bnei Israel will go to Egypt? Why Yaakov, he had to suffer that he was sold by his brothers to Egypt, and he was slave in Egypt, and during 22 years, Yaakov Avinu he didn't see Yosef. Why HaKadosh Baruch Hu he had to make suffer Yaakov with Yosef? There is other ways. Hashem, you want that the Bnei Israel, they will go to Egypt? Okay, tell Yaakov, hey, it's an order. Go to Egypt, that's it, that's that. And Yaakov, you have to obey. You understand me? Why Hashem had to do all this? Because Yaakov, he wanted to relax. What kind of relax? Has Shalom. Understand if Yaakov, he stops studying Torah, that he will get punishment. Understand. But because he wants to study Torah in relax, in comfort, you punish him. Now tell me, Mister, the yeshivot. You go to the kollel, yes? You go to the yeshiva. And the yeshiva, there is air conditioning, yes or no?
Sorry, isn't it?
Of course there is. Today it's impossible to study Torah without air conditioning. It's impossible. Yeah. In the summer, it's impossible. And what about in Canada, in America, in Europe, when it's very cold, in Russia, when it's very cold? Imagine there is no heat to heat the Beit HaMikdash. No one can study Torah. And, I mean, Baruch Hashem, today we have air conditioning. I mean, today there is good food in the yeshiva, and because they give me good food, and because they give me good bed, and because they give me air conditioning in the yeshiva, so Hashem is going to punish me? Why? It's normal. My friend, here we are not talking about David Pinto. Here we are not talking about Yaakov Vidon or Moshe Cohen. Here we are talking about Yaakov Avinu. You understand? Yaakov Avinu, he is the symbol of the Torah. You understand me? Yaakov Avinu is not a Rosh Yeshiva. Yaakov Avinu, he is the one, the father of all Am Israel. We learn from him. We cannot take a Yaakov Avinu as a sample, as an example, if he studied Torah with relax. It's impossible. For Yaakov Avinu, it's impossible. We cannot learn that from him. It's impossible. I know there is a story about Rabbi Chaim Pinto. That Rabbi Chaim Pinto never he wear a pyjama. My father told me that Rabbi Chaim Pinto the first, the one who is buried in Isawera, when he used to sleep in his chair, never sleep. And when he used to sleep a few hours with the book open. Never sleep. You know, the Maharsha Alav HaShalom, to avoid that he would not sleep, you know what he used to do? He used to bring ice, cold water, and he used to put his feet on the ice of water so he would not sleep. Can you imagine that? Do you know, Hillel HaZaken, it was one day that they didn't let him go inside the Beit HaMidrash because he didn't pay. So you know what he did? He went to the roof to try to listen the Shi'o of Shemaya Ve'Avtalion. And he was snowing. And so much he was concentration to try to listen the shiur from Shemaiah ve'Avta Elyon, so he frees. And Shemaiah Shemaiah ve'Avta Elyon, he saw like something on the glass, on the roof. They went upstairs and they saw Hillel HaZaken that he was freezing and he was dying. That was Shabbat. You know what they did? They put the fire on to give him life. You understand? Yaacov Avinu Alav HaShalom, it was the one that is supposed to be all his life. You know the Torah said that Yaacov Avinu, the Torah don't mention the Torah and Parashat Vayechi, that Yaakov Avinu passed away. The Torah don't mention that Yaakov Avinu died. The Torah just said Vayikvar, that he stopped. But not the word dying, Vayamut. The Torah mentioned about Abraham that he passed away, Vayamut, and Sarah, Meta, Yitzhak, she died. But on Abraham Avinu, the Torah don't mention that he died. You know why? Because all the time, even when he was sleeping, he was studying Torah. He never slept. Oh, he was a man of Torah all the time. So the Torah, he didn't mention that he died. So, my friend, for a man like Yaakov Avinu, that he is the sample of the Torah, the one that he was going from tent to tent, from yeshiva to yeshiva, he was the one that he did not learn from Lavan, he did not learn from Esav to be like them. He was the one who fight against the angel and he beat him. He was the one, a man of Torah. A man of Torah should be an example for Am Yisrael, for the generation to come. And I would like to give you an example and something that you never heard in your life. And now listen to it. We see that all the Torah that Yaakov Avinu, he learned from Shem Ve'ever, all the Torah that Yaakov Avinu, he learned by himself, he teach it to Yosef. To Yosef. Because Yosef was very clever. He used to catch everything. But the Torah said, suddenly, Yosef, he started to brush his hair as a young boy. You know, to brush his hair. Do you brush your hair? Why you brush your hair? To make yourself nicer, yes or no? Yeah, you brush your hair. So you can imagine Yosef at Tzadik, he brushed his hair. And then Yosef at Tzadik, he started to talk Lashon Hara about his brothers. I would like to ask you one question. How can Yosef do that? How can Yosef at Tzadik, that we called him Tzadik Yisod Olam, was a big, big Tzadik. How is it possible that Yosef, how can we imagine Yosef at Tzadik brushing his hair? How can we imagine Yosef at Tzadik going talking bad language about his brothers? How can we imagine that Yosef at Tzadik, he had bad dreams, like he was the king, like his father and mother, they bent to him, these brothers, they bent to him. I mean, look at me, sir. If I do the same dream, would I say that to my brothers, to my father? No.
No.
Because they would think that I am crazy. They think, hey, you want to be the king? You want to become the king? Ah, because you study Torah with Papa, you can allow to yourself to do whatever you want. I mean, you know why, my friend? So the question is, how Yosef become like that? Yosef is supposed to be a tzaddik. How can he push his hair? How can he talk bad language about his brother? How he suspect them that he did bad things? How can he tell his brother about the dream that he had? I mean, with the respect of Papa or Mama, I mean, even if I had a dream like that, I would not repeat it to my father and mother, because I respect them. What about respect your father and mother? Who's to accuse, sir? Whose fault? Yaacov or Yosef? My friend, the fault is Yaacov. Why? Because Yaacov Avinu is the symbol of Amal Shel Torah. You know what it is, Amal? You know what it is, Amala? The four. Effort. Always effort. To be a Jew, you need to do effort. To do a mitzvah, you need to do effort. We say mitzvah goreit mitzvah. You do a good mitzvah, it will push you to do another mitzvah. But to do so that we be pushed to do another mitzvah, you have to do the first mitzvah with effort. It's like the train. You know the train? You know the train? If the first wagon where there is the other machines, that wagon, if it is not strong, it cannot push all the wagons. You know that. To push all the wagons, you have to put on the machines. You know, you see the plane, a big plane, a 747 plane, a big one, heavy one. Who can help him to take off? The machines. Now, those machines, if you don't put them on, it cannot take off. You understand me? It cannot take off, so all the people inside, you cannot travel. There is nothing. My friend, if you do a mitzvah with effort, that will give you the strength to do more mitzvot and more mitzvot and more mitzvot. So be a good Jew, always effort on Torah, effort. But because Yaakov Avinu, he started to relax on Torah mitzvot. Well, he knew them, but be shalva. Hashem said, look your shalva, look what did your shalva, you Yaakov, you that you wanted to study Torah with shalva, look what did to Yosef. So Yosef, he took the opportunity. It's not anymore the Torah with warm, with amal. So he had some time, started to brush his hair, he had some time to talk, and they started to talk with his brothers, they started to talk bad about them, then he started to have dreams. Who caused all this? The shalva of Yaakov. Sudi Torah b'shalva. I mean, my friend, we are not Yaakov Avinu alav shalom. We are not Yaakov Avinu. But at least, we have to learn something from Yaakov. Whatever we can. Yaakov, there is always numbers. There is number one, there is number two, there is number three, there is number four. I will never forget, it was a man that used to do marathon. One day, he came to see me in New York. He told me, give me a bracha. I want to do marathon. I am. Every year I go to New York. No, he's a man from Argentina. And he told me, every year I go to New York and I do the marathon. And all year I train myself to do marathon. I told him, how many people participate in the marathon? He said, sometimes 100,000 people, sometimes, always there is a big crowd of people. So I said, what number, did you win the marathon? Have you been number one day? He said, no, I am number 30,000. Aye, aye, aye. I said 30,000. And you prepare yourself all year to be 30,000. Number 30. I told him, you know, you are very far from the number one. He said, but at least I am, and you know, I do the best. I want to be number one. I want, but these people that they are younger than me, these people that they are faster than me, so. One day, my friend has a chance to meet somebody that he was number one, the marathon, not in America, somewhere else. And then he came. Are you tired?
No, no.
And then he came. The second year, he was very sad. I told him, why you are sad? He said, well, last year, I came for a bracha to be number one, and I am only number two. So I told him, so what do you want now? He said, well, I want a good bracha, so I will be number one this year. I already was number one once, and I am number two. I'm very depressed of this end, with this number. I want to be number one. A week later, I received a phone call from him. He was crying on the telephone. He said, Rabbi, I am now number 30. I lost my title. My second title, I lost my... I told him, so stop. He said, no, I don't want to stop. I want to be number one. My friend, we have to be number one Torah. Understand me? This man, he has a, all his concern is, he works all year to be the one from Argentina. He's happy that he's number 30. He's happy. But there's other people that they have ambition. They have ambition to be number one. And when they are number two, they are not happy. When they are number 30, they are not happy. Ambition, I want to be number one. So Yaacov Avinu Alav HaShalom, he was the number one on Torah. You understand? Yaacov Avinu was the number one of Torah. And now, by sitting, by thinking, to sit and learn Torah and relax, that gives him to reduce his number one, to reduce his title. And that's why Hashem punished him. And he wanted to show him, look Yaakov, because you started to study Torah by relaxing, look what happened to Yosef. Yosef, he started to brush his hair. Yosef, the one that you teach him everything. Yosef, now we talk bad about his brothers. And that way, Yosef Abinu, Yosef HaTzadik, he was sold so that Yaakov Abinu Alav HaShalom, he was correct to become again number one. And then he become again number one. And as you see in the Parsha Vayeishev, the best years of Yaakov Avinu, of his life, the best year of his life, they were when he was in Egypt. But I was thinking that those 17 years that Yaakov Avinu was in Egypt, for me, they are the worst years of his life. Why? Because he was outside Eretz Israel. He was now in the Galut. It's the worst years. No. It was the best years. Why? Because those years, he studied Torah with his children, with the children of Yaakov Avinu, and 17, the number 17, is Gematria Tov. Tov, Tet, it's 9, Vav, 6, Bet, it's 2. Total is how much?
17.
And how old was Yaakov? How old was Yosef when Yaakov, he lost him? He was 17. And now Yaakov has been corrected. This age. Now we understand. Now I understand why Hashem punished me at the age of 17 of Yosef. Because I wanted to start to study Torah, relax. That's what happened. So what Yaakov Avinu, he did, the 17 years that he remained, the years of his life in Egypt, he fooled them in Torah with Amen. My friend, I would like to tell you a beautiful story. Beautiful story. I heard this story this week. You know, here in Israel, Baruch Hashem, I built a few mikvahot with Taharat, with a big organization of from Bernard, from Bnei Brak, with Rav Kanivsky. Baruch Hashem, I contributed a few mikvahot. And there was a mikveh in Nili. Nili, it's not far away from the border of, you know, the from Ramle, you know, Lud, you know, it's a zone of Palestinian, not Israel. And Baruch Hashem, the mikveh was built, and the mikveh, when after it was built, and Baruch Hashem, a lot of women that couldn't have children, they went to that mikveh, and they had children. A lot of times people, women, used to dream with my mother. And my mother, she used to bless them to have children. Now, they had to do some renovation to that mikveh, which Baruch Hashem I had again. So they emptied the mikveh from the work. And now, they finished the mikveh, it was in the summer, and there was no rain. Of course, here in Israel, there is no rain in the summer, there is no rain. And the owner of the mikveh, she was very sad that now the mikveh is fixed and there is no rain. And she prayed with the zechot of my mother. And beside this, there was some terrorists that used to throw, bottles of fire, on people that they passed by in the car. And she prayed with the zechot of my mother that the police, they were looking for this group and they couldn't catch them. That week, a miracle happened. The police catched the people who threw the bottle of gas. They catch them. And that night, you know what happened? No one understand. The rain was raining all night in the summer. And when the mikveh was full, it stopped. The rain stopped. How you understand this? I don't know how you understand this. All what I can tell you, this is the zechut of my mother, that she pushed us to study Torah. She loved Torah. I was 8 years old when she sent me to the yeshiva. And then she did not see me for 5 years. On 5 years, she saw me maybe twice, three times. On 5 years. But one thing is sure. For 3 years, she did not see me. She saw me 3 times on the first 2 years. But the last 3 years, she did not see me. She came when I was 13, and she did me the bar mitzvah. That's the koach of the tzaddikit. That's the effort. So, Be'at Hashem, her zechut should be with you, and with all Am Yisrael. So I would like to wish you a Shabbat Shalom, and I pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu to give you bracha v'atzlacha, and I pray to Hashem to all the people that listen to the show to give them happiness, bracha v'atzlacha, and b'riut v'ezrat Hashem.